Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending upon when you are watching this video lecture. In the earlier sessions related to process costing, we discussed the concept of preparation of process account and preparation of statement of equivalent production and the steps involved in process costing so that ultimately we find out the overall cost per unit for each process, and we have solved some of the questions related to application of these concepts, in which preparation of statement of equivalent production is also there, preparation of process account, and sometimes preparation of abnormal loss account was also there. Those are typically the questions repeated in the examinations as well. I hope you have practiced those questions well. Now let us continue solving some more questions in the same chapter using the similar concepts that we already know for more practice. Question number one in the material, that is CHAMPS material, already we have done that in the earlier session. Question number two also is done. Now let us do question number three. Question number three reads like this, read it carefully. A company produces a component which passes through two processes. During the month of April, materials for 40,000 components were put into process one, of which 30,000 were completed and transferred to process two. So input was 40,000, output transferred from process one to process two is only 30,000. That means 10,000 units are not transferred to process 2. What happened to them is also given. Those not transferred to process 2 were 100% complete as to materials cost and 50% complete as to labor and overheads cost, which means the remaining 10,000 components are work in progress naturally, and naturally there is no other losses which can be looked at here because it is matching 40,000 input, 30,000 transferred to the next process, 10,000 closing work in progress. Closing work in progress is 100% complete as to materials, 50% complete as to conversion costs. And the costs incurred in process 1 are given. 15,000 rupees direct material cost, 18,000 rupees direct wages cost, and 12,000 rupees overheads. Of those transferred to process 2, of those means how many units? 30,000 units. Of those 30,000 units, 28,000 units were completed and transferred to finished goods stores. So in process 2, input was 30,000 units, output was 28,000 completed units. And there was a normal loss with no salvage value of 200 units in process 2. So out of 30,000, 28,000 is gone, that means completed. 200 units is normal loss, that means still 1,800 units are there, that's what is mentioned. There were 1,800 units remained unfinished in the process, that means work in progress, with 100% complete as to materials and 25% only complete as to wages and overheads. So here also the physical flow is matching. 30,000 inputted, 28,000 completed, 1,800 closing work in progress, 200 normal loss. That too doesn't have any salvage value. No further process material cost incurred after introduction at the first process until the end of the second process. So no materials is introduced in the second process. Only after the second process is complete. In other words, once the goods are finished, then only there is some protective packing that is applied to the completed components. So will this be also incurred for the work in progress in the process too? Definitely not. Why? Because this protective packing is only done after the goods are completed. Means this will be incurred only on the completed units of 28,000, not on the work in progress of 1,800 units. That has to be applied and understood from this information. Very clearly, this protective packing is applied to completed components only, not for others. The process and packing costs incurred at the end of the process 2 are like this. Packing materials, which is only applied to the completed components. wages and overheads will be applied to everything because people have to work. So 3500, 4500 will be there in process two, applicable to wages and overheads. Whereas packing material will be only applicable to closing, that is finished goods at the end of process two, not to the closing work in progress of process two. That is one point to be identified from the information. Now what is required is preparing statement of equivalent production, cost per unit and process accounts for both process one as well as process two. That's what is asked. You just need to prepare statement of equivalent production, cost per unit calculation and process accounts for each of the processes. So let us start with the statement of equivalent production for each of those processes, naturally starting with process one. Of course, we can match the physical input with output because it is very clear. We are not doing it separately. In the examination, you can do it as a working notes, no problem. 40,000 units are inputted, 30,000 units completed, and remaining 10,000 units are work in progress. So directly, we can prepare statement of equivalent production for process one straight away. As usual, there will be particulars. Not amount, units here, that is the left hand side, and right hand side also there will be particulars and units. Then we have to distinguish material, labor and overheads. Both are completed 50% only, so there is no problem. Materials are completed 100%. So we can have one column for labor and overheads. Within these materials, we should have percentage also and units also. Within this labor and overheads also, there should be a percentage column and units column. This is a statement of equivalent production. Anytime, any question, same way we will prepare. So let us see what happened in the beginning. New units are introduced. So how many components were put into process one? So you can call them units introduced. How many? 40,000 are introduced. That's it. Nothing else. So this 40,000 has to be matched with what happened to that 40,000 as right hand side. What happened to them? Completed units are there, completed and transferred to next process. How many? 30,000 units are completed and transferred to next process. Once they are completed, naturally everything will be 100%. Percentage is already there, so 100%. Even for labor and overheads also it will be 100%. That means units will be 30,000, that is equivalent units. Then ending work in progress or closing work in progress, that is how much? 10,000 components. No opening work in progress is given, so doesn't matter. FIFO, weighted average, both are same. So closing work in progress is 10,000, and here how much of that is complete? 100% complete for materials and 50% only completed when it comes to labor and overhead. So that means 100% of 10,000 is 10,000, 50% of 10,000 is only 5,000. Now the total matches on the right hand side, that will definitely match, no losses, nothing. And equivalent units for materials also is 40,000 since all are 100% complete. But equivalent units for labor and overheads is only 35,000 units. That's it. That is a statement of equivalent production. Once you have this, you have to prepare the statement of cost. Statement of cost should be ideally prepared for materials, labor and overheads separately. If there was opening work in progress, we would have taken that. Since there is no opening work in progress, directly we can take whatever the cost that is incurred during this process. So cost incurred during this process is given 15,000 material cost, 18,000 rupees, that is labor cost, 12,000 rupees overheads, that is factory overheads cost. That's all. And we have equivalent units already. Number of equivalent units is how much? For materials it is 40,000. For labor and overheads it was 35,000. Which means what is going to be the cost per equivalent unit? 15,000 divided by 40,000. Calculate that. 15 by 40. That is 0.375. Labor 18 by 35, 0.514, let us say. Then overheads 0.343, let us say. There will be definitely rounding errors, that's not an issue, but just round it to 2 or 3 decimals maximum according to your convenience. Now this is the cost per unit, but this has to be used for the purpose of calculating the what is the cost of completed units and transfer to next process and what is the cost of closing work in progress. For completed units, because anyway all are complete, you can directly take total cost. So, cost of completed and transferred units. Will be how much? Take the total of all these three. 0.375 plus 0.514 plus 0.343 into, that comes to 1.232. 1.232 multiplied with completed units are 30,000 units. So what is the cost of them? 1.232 into 30,000, approximately 36,960. That is the cost of completed and transferred units to the next process. That is 36,960. Then what about the closing work in progress cost? That we have to calculate separately for materials, labor and overheads. How can be that done? Closing work in progress can be calculated like this. 10,000 units of closing work in progress in terms of materials multiplied with 0.375 plus how many equivalent units here? Not 10,000. For labor and overheads it is only 5,000 units of closing work in progress is there. So 5,000 units of closing work in progress for labor multiplied with 0.514, same way overheads also 5,000 units multiplied with 0.343, that total of this will be closing work in progress. Calculate that. 10,000 into 0.375, 5,000 into 0.514, 5,000 into 0.343. Total will be around 8,035. Just calculate it. In the process account, we can round it. Now just calculate and keep it ready. So the cost of finished goods or completed units and transferred to the next process is 36,960. Closing work in progress cost is 8,035. And this is all related to process one only. And what he has asked is statement of equivalent production, done. Cost per unit, done. Process one account is yet to be prepared. Let us prepare that also. Process one account. These are 10 marks questions. Always possible to be asked. Two processes is much more possible than one process. So process one account, as usual, if you take units and value, units and value, what is the new units introduced, cost anyway we know that. So let us take two materials. Materials number of units was 40,000. Value was 15,000 rupees. Two, direct wages, 18,000 rupees. Two, factory overheads, 12,000 rupees. That is the total of left hand side. Number of units wise, naturally it is 40,000. Amount wise, 18 plus 12, 30 plus 15, 45,000 it is, total of it. It should match with the right hand side, obviously. That is our job, finally, to make sure all our calculations are correct. Now, in this, buy completed and transferred to the next process, 30,000 units. Value, as we just calculated, take that 36,960. Buy. Closing. Work in progress. 10,000 units. Total is 40,000 units matched. Amount should match 45,000. So take the balancing figure. So 45,000 minus 36,960 is 8,040. So 5 rupees difference is there, that's okay. 8,040. We got 8,035. No problem. So this is the process one account. Now the story is not over. The story continues to process two. And in the process two also the same things happen. Units transferred from process one are 30,000 units. Out of them, 28,000 units are completed and transferred to the finished goods stores. 200 units are normal loss and 1800 units remained unfinished in the process itself. So once again we have to do the statement of equivalent production for process 2. So what is the statement of equivalent production for process 2? Same thing, no difference in the format, always just use the same format. Particulars, units, left hand side, right hand side, particulars, units, that's okay. Then materials, labor and overhead separately we have to take. Here also it is given 100% complete in terms of materials, 25% completed regards to wages and overhead. So we can take materials separately, labor and overheads completely separate. In this also naturally we have percentages and units. Again here percentage and units. So let us take the data that is there. So transferred from process 1. Transferred from process 1, how many units here? 30,000 units. And what happened to those 30,000 units? 28,000 units are completed and transferred to finished goods. So again, completed and transferred. 28,000 units. And normal loss was 200 units. And closing work in progress was 1,800 units. So the units wise, it has matched left hand side, right hand side. 30,000 and 30,000. These all details are given in the question. Now let us find out equivalent units. So 28,000 naturally for materials when it is 100%, it will be 28,000 only. No difference. But when it comes to the normal loss, as we know, we should not take anything in the equivalent production. That should be taken as nil, nil, nil. Closing work in progress, according to the percentages what are given, he said 100% for materials, 25% only relation to labor and overheads. Whatever it is, 100% materials means 1800, 20% of 25% of 1800 will be 450 for labor and overheads. So 29,800 for materials, 28,450 for labor and overheads is the equivalent units in process 2. That is the statement of equivalent production. So once again, costs we have to take. Costs, even we take, we have to take once again materials. Labor and overheads. So here in process 2, no further process material costs are incurred after the introduction at the first process. So there is no material cost at all particularly. So what will be there? Only whatever the units which are coming from process 1 to process 2, that only will be the material cost. And what was that? We know the amount already. The same amount has to come here, 36,960. That is the material cost coming from process 1 to process 2. For process 1, it was transferred out. For process 2, that is transferred in. So 36,960, as we already calculated, will be the only material cost here. No further material cost is introduced. But labor and overheads are incurred, that is 35 and 45. 3,500 and 4,500, they are introduced. Now, this material cost packing will not be applicable for work in progress. That will be only applicable for finished goods, which are 28,000 in number. So we cannot take it now. We can take it later when we have value the finished goods, but not while finding out the individual per unit material, labor and overhead costs per equivalent unit. So 36,960, 3,500, 4,500 are material, labor and overhead costs. Then we have equivalent units already known. 29,800 for materials and 28,450 for labor, and same $28,450 for overheads also. Then naturally, what is going to be the cost per unit here? So 36,960 divided by 29,800. That comes to 1.24. 3,500 divided by 28,450. That comes to 0.123. 4,500 divided by 28,450. That comes to 0.158. But these are cost per equivalent unit. That is cost per equivalent unit. But that is not the final cost. This cost can be used for valuation of work in progress, no problem. But this cost cannot be used for valuation of completed and transferred units. Why? Because additional cost of 4,000 has been incurred on packing of the completed units. But let us first find out the value of work in progress. Then we can go to the computation of value of finished goods at the end of the period. So work in progress, if we calculate, how many number of units are there? 1800 for materials. So 1800 into 1.24, 450 into 0.123, and also 450 into 0.158. That is the total cost of Closing work in progress. Do that calculation. 1800 into 1.24, 450 into 0.123, 450 into 0.158. Total comes to 2,358. That is the total of closing stock of work in progress at end of process 2. But when it comes to the computation of closing stock of finished goods which are going to be sold later, there we have to calculate cost definitely, plus we have to add 4,000 rupees also package cost, that care has to be taken. So how many units are there? Broadly 28,000 units are there, completed units. So let us take the total first. 28,000 into what is the total of all these three? 1.24 plus 0.123 plus 0.158, total is 1.521 into 28,000. So 1.521 is this. That comes to 42,588. But add 4,000 to that, that will give the total cost of finished goods completed, 46,588. Now, once we have these numbers, because he has asked cost per unit also as a question, you can find out 46,588 divided by 28,000. That comes to per unit cost 1.664. That is asked in the question. So that also you can find out cost per unit 1.664. That is the unit of finished goods. But he has also asked process account. So let us prepare that also. Process to account, same way we'll have units and value, units and value. Units are basically what which are introduced, transferred from process one. Transferred from process 1. How many units have come from process 1? We know that 30,000 units have come. And what is the value of them? 36,960. We know that. 36,960. Then, 2. Wages, 2 overheads, 2 packing cost. 3 costs are incurred in this process. So wages cost is how much? 3,500, overheads 4,500. Packing is not just material cost, no units there, just 4,000 rupees. Packing cost is also incurred in addition to this other costs. So simply, the total of left hand side will be how much? That should be 30,000 naturally. Then the total of all this, do the calculation. 36,960 plus 3,500 plus 4,500 plus 4,000. 48,960. How this will be broken up? What is the breakup of this? By finished goods, completed, 28,000 units. So 28,000 units of finished goods, what is the value of that? Already we have found out, 46,588. 46,588. By normal loss, 200 units is there, but no value because there is no scrap value. By closing work in progress, 1800 units, which matches the total of units column first of all. But 48,960, in order this to be matched, Let us take the remaining as balancing figure. 48,960 minus 46,588. 2,372 is the closing work in progress. That is a balancing figure. But check that with what we already calculated. 2,358. 2,358 is what we calculated. 2,372 is what we got. 14 rupees difference. Why? Rounding error. No problem. Don't worry about it. Don't even think about it. 2,372 is the closing work in progress. That matches the overall cost also. That is process 2 account also. This is a comprehensive question with two processes. And from first process, the units are going to the second process. And in each process, we have calculated the cost per unit or cost per equivalent unit by preparing statement of equivalent production and then finding out the cost per unit or cost per equivalent unit. Then cost of completed units and the cost of closing work in progress is calculated. And whatever is transferred from process 1, that comes to process 2. And again for process 2, the same process has to apply. Again, statement of equivalent production. Once again, cost per equivalent unit, applying it to compute the closing value of finished goods and closing work in progress. So the entire process will give us 10 marks. That is this question number 3. Perfect question for 10 marks. 1 is a little bit practice type question, but still possible. 2 is quite possible. Most probably the questions like 2 will come with little bit of more information or less information. And 3 is also a fantastic model which was asked many a time earlier, wherein two processes or more. More will be generally rare because 2 itself will take a lot of time, as you observed. More practice will give you quicker answering capacity. So practice is what very important in this chapter, as I already told. I am reiterating that once again. Right? That is about question number 3. Question number 4 is a kind of, I would say, more than process costing. It is like a departmental accounts type question. But doesn't matter. Accounts are costing questions which are giving us some information. We have to solve them. Departmental accounts also will be very similar. But we'll come to this inter-process profit situations at a later stage. And question number 5 is once again quite a popular type of question. This also has some profit, but it is not inter-process profit. Certain goods are sold in the first process itself. This is also past examination question, as you can observe. Question number 5. A product passes through two processes, A and B. During the year 2011, the input to process A of basic raw materials was 8,000 units at the rate of 9 rupees per unit. And other information is given for the year. Output units is 7,500 only for process A. 8,000 units inputted, but 7,500 only output means what? 500 units lost. But ideally, the normal loss is supposed to be 5% of input. So 8,000 units input, 5% means 400 only should be the normal loss. But 500 has become the real loss. What is that 100? Naturally, abnormal loss. Then scrap value per unit is given. Direct wages is given. Direct expenses is also given. Selling price per unit is given in relation to this process A, that is selling price per unit. Which is 15 rupees. Why selling price per unit is given? Maybe some of the units of process A are sold here itself. So that is the point, again, little different in this question. But ultimately the remaining things are same. And also other information given here is total overheads are 17,400 and these are recovered as a percentage of direct wages. So we have to first distribute this 17,400 in 1:2 ratio because direct wages are 12,000 and 24,000. 17,400 have to be distributed between process A and B in 1:2 ratio. Selling expenses were 5,000. They were not allocated to the processes. When it is given clearly, you should not allocate. Selling expenses there, I will allocate. No need to allocate. If it is given, not allocated, don't allocate to the process. Leave it. Maybe it will be charged to the profit and loss account directly, not related to process A or process B. But look at the other information. 2/3 of the output of process A was passed on to the next process. So how much was output of process A first of all? 7500 units as given. 2/3 of that has been passed on to the next process. So how much will be input to process B first of all? That will be 5000 units, isn't it? 2/3 of 7500 will be 5000 units. That is first point. And then what happened to remaining 1/3, that is 2500 units? Those are sold. These 2500 units are sold at a price of 15 rupees there itself in the process A, and remaining 5000 units are transferred to next process. Entire output of process B was sold. Naturally, process B must be the final process. A process had some units which are transferred to the next process, and some units could be sold in that way. They were sold at 15 rupees. That is a point here to be noted. At process A, there is a sale also. That is a little variety point. Doesn't make difference. Finally, 5000 units are inputted to process B. In that, normal loss is 5%, means 500 units, but actually the output of process B is 4800. So how much is abnormal gain here? That means 300 units. That is another point to be identified with physical flow. 5000 units inputted to process B, normal loss is supposed to be 500 because it is 10%, but real production is 4800. Real production supposed to be 4500 only, but actually it became 4800, means 300 units abnormal gain is there. Then scrap value per unit is given 10 rupees. That will be related to the normal loss. Direct wages is given, direct expenses is given naturally, and whatever the overheads applicable to process B will be there, those will be allocated anyway. And finally, the selling price of units completed in process B, which is 4800 units, will be sold at 25 rupees. Prepare process A and B accounts. That's all. That is a question, pure examination type of question, which can be asked also. Let us prepare those process A and process B accounts. So first thing first, in both the process there is no closing work in progress, so there is no need of statement of equivalent production and all. Just process accounts are enough. So let us prepare first process A account. Account is similar. It will have units also and value also. Particulars of course will be there. Units and value. Let us start with the input. What happened here in process A? The input to process A of basic raw material was 8000 units at the rate of 9 rupees per unit. So two direct materials, let us say, or raw materials you can call it, 8000 units with a value of 9 rupees per unit. So 8000 into 9, 72000 rupees will be the value of that materials. Then there is direct wages given in the question, 12000 rupees. Then there are other direct expenses, that is also given in the question, that is 6000 rupees. Then comes overheads. Overheads, what he has given, 17400 to be recovered as a percentage of direct wages. That means 17400 can be distributed between process A and B in the same ratio of 12:24 or 1:2. So distribute this 17400 in 1:2 ratio. So 17400 divided by 3, that is 1. That means 5800 for process A multiply with 2, 11600 for process B. That's it. Now we take 5800. That is for process A. So we have all the costs here, and units are also there. Let us not close them, but just understand the physical flow first. What happened to this 8000 units? Output was 7500, in which 5000 are transferred to process B, 2500 are sold, but normal loss is supposed to be 400 only. So taking, let us say, normal loss, it should be 5% of input. That means 400 only. But the 7500 is not matching. Say, by process B, how many units are transferred? Only 5000. Remaining units are sold. In process accounts, unless each process is a profit center or a responsibility center, we don't have to record any sales. If it is given, then we can take as sales directly and take the profit also. If not, it is always better, because process is only for cost purposes. Mostly processes are cost centers. When they will be profit centers? When there is an interdepartmental profit or inter-process profit, then we can call them as profit centers. In this case, there is no such case. So let us assume that this is only a cost center. So that means the 2500, whatever it is, number of units and respective value, can be transferred to the profit and loss account as cost of goods sold in this process. So that is 2500 units by P&L account, we can say. Process B, 5000 units, P&L account 2500 units, 7500 is the output of process A. But normal loss is 400 only, it is not matching. Total should be 8000. So which side there is a gap? This side, which means it is abnormal loss. That is how we have to match the physical flow. Now the normal loss is given with a scrap value of 2 rupees. That means value will be 800, no problem. And abnormal loss value we have to do. But look at the debit side value, total of that 72,000 plus 12,000 plus 6,000 plus 5,800 means 95,800 is the value debit side. Then all the remainings are equally valued per unit. Abnormal loss transferred to process B or transferred to P&L account or sold. Cost of all of them is same per unit. So how much will be that cost? That can be found out easily. 95,800 minus 800 divided by 8,000 minus 400. That means 7,600. This already we discussed. How to find out cost per unit. How to find out the total of cost minus sale proceeds of normal loss divided by the total of units minus normal loss units. That comes to 12.5 per unit. Just multiply with 100, you will get 1250 here. Multiply with 5000, you will get 62,500. That is the cost of the units transferred to next process. Then half of that will be cost, once again, not selling price, cost of the units which are sold in this process itself. But we are transferring it to P&L account because process A is assumed to be not a responsibility center. Total of this should match naturally. That is how we made the calculations. So 800 plus 1250 plus 62,500 plus 31,250 should be. Yeah. 95,800 total should match naturally. 95,800 units matched, values matched. That's it. That is process A account. Now, process B account. Same way we can prepare process B account also. Once again, units, value. Units, value, or you can say amount also. How many units are coming from process A to process B? What is the input into process B? 5000 units are coming with a cost of 62,500. So process B gets 2. Transfer from process A. Transfer from process A is how many units? 5000 units, 62,500 cost. Yeah, that's what is transferred from process A. But here once again you have to match the quantity. Output was 4800, whereas normal loss is supposed to be 500. Then direct wages and direct expenses costs are anyway there. So let us take the costs first. It is easy to copy paste. To direct wages cost, that is 24,000. To overheads, sorry, direct overheads, let us take. Anyway, we have taken already 11,600. Two direct expenses also are there, that is 5,000. So 24,000, 5,000, 11,600 are the costs incurred in process B. Then don't total the units and all, because in this case we have to already match the physical flow. Abnormal gain is there. Why is that? Because output units are 4,800. So let us say by finished goods, or you can say by P&L account, because ultimately they are going to be sold by P&L account. That is 4,800 units. P&L account will not have any units. Value of them, the cost of them will have to be transferred to P&L account. But number of units completed are 4,800. By normal loss, normal loss is 10% of input, that is 10% of 5,000, which comes to 500. And what is the scrap value here? 10 rupees. So 500 into 10 rupees means 5,000 rupees is the value of normal loss. But there is abnormal gain here. Why is that? Because this total is 5,300, but left side it is only 5,000. So 5,300 here it is only 5,000. So why there is a difference? That is abnormal gain. How much is the value of abnormal gain? That we have to find out. It will be same as the cost of goods which are completed and transferred to the next process. But before totaling, you have to do this process. 62,500 plus 24,000 plus 11,600 plus 5,000 minus 5,000 divided by 5,000 minus 500. That means 4,500. So 62,500 plus 24,000 plus 11,600 plus 5,000 minus 5,000 divided by 4,500. So that comes to 21.8. But this calculation should be done before writing the value of abnormal gain and what is transferred to the finished goods or P&L account. 21.8, how we got it? Total of all the debit side, 62,500 plus 24 plus 11,600 plus 5,000 minus the value of normal loss divided by 5,000 units inputted minus 500, that is 4,500. That comes to 21.8 per unit. So 21.8 into 300 will be how much? 6,540. That is abnormal gain. Same 21.8 into 4,800 will be how much? 1,04,640. Now total both sides, of course, they should be same. 1,09,640 left hand side. Also total it 1,09,640. That is abnormal gain value and other things in process B account. So we have process A account and process B account. Actually, as far as question is concerned, this is enough, but doesn't make sense. Why? Because what is the profit actually made? Because the sales price is also given, that is not reflected in the process accounts itself. So it is better always, and that is the inherent meaning also of the question, that we have to prepare a profit and loss account. You want to call it costing profit and loss account, you can call it costing profit and loss account. One by one, we have to take the costs and other things also. Let us take from process A account. Process A account. How much was the cost of the goods that has transferred to profit and loss account? 31,250. Isn't it? So that was the cost of goods sold, process A. You can call it to cost of goods sold from process A. How much is that? 31,250. Same way, what is the cost of goods sold from process B? Process B. We have it already. 1,04,640. By sales. Sales also. Process A, process B, separately you can calculate. It is given in the question. Selling price in process A was 15 rupees. How many units? 2,500 units are sold. That means 37,500 rupees is the sales related to process A. 37,500. Process B. Selling price was 25 rupees. How many units? 4,800 units into 25. 1,20,000 is the sales of process B. Total you can do 1,57,500. That is the total sales for the company as a whole. But the story is not over. Now you have to also debit the abnormal loss. While doing the abnormal loss or abnormal gain, as we discussed already, we have to reduce the scrap value. For example, in the first process, abnormal loss was valued at 12.5. What was the scrap value in the first process? 2 rupees. That should be reduced. So what will be the real abnormal loss? Only 10.5. So 12.5 minus 2 rupees, 10.5. into 100, so abnormal loss will be 1050 from process A. So 2 abnormal loss from process A, 1050. Same logic applies to abnormal gain also. Abnormal gain was valued at what price? 21.8 minus what is the scrap value in process B? 10 rupees. That means 21.8 minus 10, 11.8 into how many units of abnormal gain is there? 300 units of abnormal gain is there. So 11.8 into 300, 3540 will be abnormal gain. That is a separate working note. So 3540 is the abnormal gain that should be naturally credited to the costing profit and loss account. This is abnormal gain. How much is that? 3540. So what are the per unit cost minus scrap value multiplied with number of units? That is how abnormal loss and abnormal gain have to be taken. Normal loss is already accounted for. There is no separate accounting treatment for normal loss. Already the good units have taken the hit of normal loss. That is how the cost per unit was already inflated because of normal loss. So that is about process A, process B, and then profit and loss account. And by the way, this is the place where you can debit your selling expenses, which are not allocated to the process. Definitely yes, because that is a common expenditure. Selling expenses, how much was that? 5,000 rupees can be debited to costing P&L account. Now find out what is the profit or loss. 3540 plus 157,500, that is on one side. 31,250, 1,04,640, 1,050 plus 5,000 on another side. So 141,940 is there. Other side is more. So what is the profit? 19,100 rupees is the profit to net profit. Of course, you have to write the totals always. What is the total? 157,500 plus 3540, 161,040. In any account, anywhere, accounts are costing, wherever any account is prepared, if you don't write the total, that is the worst possible message you can give to the valuer. I have observed some of the people are not writing it, that is not correct. Anytime, there should be total compulsorily. If you are not doing total, it is your rough work, not an examination answer. So, make sure you write totals always. 161,040 is the total. And profit is 19,100. That's it. That is the question given in the examination. 19,100 profit is the answer. Such kind of questions can be expected also from process costing. Now, you have to do this question as a task, you can say. Same type of question, question number 7. MJ Private Limited produces a product Sky which passes through two processes, process A and process B. Details are given. 40,000 units are introduced at a cost of 360,000 in process A. Material further consumed beyond that 40,000 units. And direct wages, manufacturing expenses are also given. Output in units is given. Out of 40,000, 37,000 only came, which means 3,000 lost. But 40,000 into 5% means only 2,000. That means 1,000 abnormal loss is there in the first process. Scrap value is given for process A, 15 rupees, and second process 20 rupees. Selling price is also given, 37 rupees, 61 rupees. And additional information is given. 80% of the output of process A was passed on to the next process. 80%. And the balance was sold. The entire output of process B was sold. Indirect expenses were 448,080 and nothing is mentioned about it. How to split them between process A and B? Which means what? They don't need to be split. They can be directly, straight away, debited to costing P&L account. When it is not given, don't worry about it. If it is given on any basis, then split it according to the basis that is given. So process A, process B need not carry any indirect expenses at all. What is required is prepare process A account and process B account, and definitely this is important, prepare profit and loss account showing the net profit or net loss for the year. This is there in CHAMPS material, problem number 7. If by chance you don't have it, pause it now and write it down on paper, the question itself. Then solve it as one of the tasks today. So copy this question by pausing the video now and copying it. This is the question, basically the details about process A and B. Then additional information is also given. Take that also. Pause it and copy it first. Then solve the question. Right? That is question number 7. Question number 6, I think we did already. Right? Yeah. Question number 6 was done already. 5 is what we did just now. 1, 2, 3 are done. 4 is related to inter-process profits. That is one more special type of situation. But yes, that is just more like a departmental account type situation. 8th question is also very normal question, which is related to process A and all the details related to closing work in progress and units is scrapped also. Degree of completion is given separately. Only point here is, instead of asking average basis, what is asked here is FIFO basis. So this question, along with some more questions related to process costing, we'll continue the discussion in the next session, and then we can close this chapter for discussion as far as the class is concerned, and then I will also ask you to do some more tasks. But as of now, immediately what you are supposed to do is solve this question number 7. That is your immediate task. keep it with you. Don't need to send it, but do this one. Question number 7. Right? Fine then. We'll conclude today's session with that, and in the next session we'll conclude the process costing chapter itself. Till then, take care. Bye bye. Thank you very much.